welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from John Russell and Katie Weaver. Later, we present an everyday grammar lesson all about adverbs and adjectives. We close the show with a visit to Big Bend National Park in Texas. But first, here is John Russell.
The idea of turning Mars into a livable world for humans is a common element of science fiction. But could such an action be done in real life? Scientists are now proposing a new method to warm up Earth's planetary neighbor. The idea involves putting engineered particles made of iron or aluminum into the atmosphere. The goal is to trap escaping heat and direct sunlight toward the Martian surface. The proposed idea would be to increase the natural greenhouse effect on Mars and raise its surface temperature by around 28 degrees Celsius over 10 years. Such a change alone would not make Mars livable for people. But the scientists who developed the idea see it as a possible first step. Edwin Kite of the University of Chicago helped lead the study that appeared recently in the publication Science Advances. Kite described the process of terraforming, meaning to change a planet's environment to be more like Earth. For Mars, warming the planet is a necessary but insufficient first step. Previous concepts have focused on releasing greenhouse gases, but these require large amounts of resources that are scarce on Mars, he said. Kite added that climate modeling suggests the new idea of using engineered particles to warm Mars's atmosphere could work better than previous ideas. Kite explained that the work is important because it presents a possible method that could help future exploration plans. NASA has sent robotic vehicles to explore the Martian surface and the InSight lander to study the planet's interior. The U.S. Space Agency's Artemis program aims to put astronauts in the coming years on the moon's surface for the first time since 1972, in preparation for possible future human missions to Mars. There are several barriers to human settlements on Mars. They include a lack of breathable oxygen, harmful ultraviolet radiation, salty soil, and dust storms that sometimes cover much of the planet. And Mars's cold temperatures are a serious issue. The median Martian surface temperature is about minus 65 degrees Celsius. With its thin atmosphere, solar heat on the Martian surface easily escapes into space. The proposal would aim to permit liquid water to exist on the surface of Mars, which has water in the form of ice at its polar areas and its subsurface. The scientists proposed continuously releasing tiny particles, called nanorods, into the atmosphere at a rate of about 30 liters per second for years. Samane Ansari of Northwestern University in Illinois is the study's lead writer. Ansari said, "The idea is to either ship the material or, better yet, ship the manufacturing tool and make the nanorods on the planet since iron and aluminum are abundant on the surface of Mars. The researchers are mindful of the possibility of unintended consequences in terraforming another world. Scientists, for instance, are eager to learn whether Mars has held life in the past, or perhaps currently, in the form of subsurface microbes. Kite suggested that the costs and benefits of releasing nanorods are uncertain. For example, he said if Mars's soil has compounds that are harmful to life from Earth, then the benefit of warming Mars is zero. I'm John Russell.
Researchers are one step closer to understanding how Britain's ancient circular structure, Stonehenge, was created. The circle of huge rocks stands in southern England, near the tip of northeast Scotland. Its so-called altar stone lies flat in the center. The new study finds that the huge altar stone did not come from nearby Wales, as had been thought. The researchers say the rock instead was carried to the site from the more distant Scotland. Nature magazine published the study on Wednesday. The research did not show how the 5-meter-long stone was carried to the site, but the scientists said it traveled about 740 kilometers. "It's a surprise that it's come from so far away," said University of Exeter archaeologist Susan Graney, who was not involved in the study. For more than 100 years, scientists believed that Stonehenge's central sandstone slab, long called the altar stone, came from much closer Wales. But a study last year by some of the researchers showed that the stone did not match the geology of Wales sandstone formations. The actual source of the stone remained unknown until now. For the study, the team tested mineral content in pieces of rock that had been collected in past digs. They found a match in the sandstone formations of Orcadian Basin in northeastern Scotland. The area includes parts of the end of the Scottish Peninsula, as well as the Orkney Islands. That geological fingerprint isn't repeated in any other area of sediment in the UK, said Aberystwyth University geologist Nick Pierce, one of the study writers. Graney said the operational complexity of moving the stone so far suggests a high level of planning, cooperation, and cultural connection between these two parts of ancient Britain. Stonehenge went up around 5,000 years ago. Its design creates a kind of window that fully frames the sun as it rises on the summer solstice. The ancient purpose of the altar stone remains a mystery. Stonehenge isn't a settlement site, but a place of ceremony, said Heather Sabir with English Heritage, an aid organization that cares for hundreds of historic British sites and structures. Sabir said that past archaeological digs had not uncovered evidence of daily living at Stonehenge. Past research has shown cultural connections, such as similarities in pottery making, between the area around Stonehenge and Scotland's Orkney Islands. Other stones at Stonehenge came from Western Wales. Britain is home to other ancient stone circles, but study writer Richard Bevins of Aberystwyth University says, "The thing that's unique about Stonehenge is the distance from which the stones have been sourced." I'm Katie Weaver.
Katie Weaver joins me now to talk more about that report. Hi, Katie. Nice to talk with you.
Thanks, Ashley. I'm glad to be here.
This story includes several words that are not in our Learning English word book, and a few of them relate to one another. They all kind of relate to Earth.
Right. The non-living matter, generally.
Can you tell us about a couple of these words?
So, this is a story about geology, for starters. The first part of the word, geo, refers to Earth. The rest of the word means study or thought. The Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines geology as the science that deals with the history of the Earth and its life, especially as recorded in rocks.
And what about peninsula?
A peninsula is a landform. It is a long and narrow area of land that extends into the ocean or other body of water.
And let's finish up with sediment.
That is the material that sinks to the bottom of a body of water. Normally, it is made up of soil and very small rocks and shells. You know, earthy stuff.
Okay, thanks so much for those explanations, Katie. And thank you for that report.
My pleasure.
For VOA Learning English, this is Everyday Grammar. This week, we're going to talk about some common problems with adverbs. Basically, adverbs are words that describe verbs, adjectives, and other adverbs. For example, I ran quickly to the store. The adverb quickly describes the verb run.
If a word is not easy to classify as a noun, verb, or adjective, it is probably an adverb. Some of the most common words in English are adverbs, including up, so, just, then, how, now, also, here, and more. Adverbs usually describe verbs. They express when, how, where, and why an action is done. Many adverbs are easy to find because they have the ly ending, such as quickly, surely, and certainly. However, many adverbs do not have the ly ending. Adverbs can also describe adjectives. For example, it is really cold today. In this example, really is an adverb that describes the adjective cold. Adverbs can describe other adverbs. For example, I will probably never go back. Here, the adverb probably describes the adverb never.
Where do adverbs go in a sentence? Well, it depends. Some adverbs can go almost anywhere in a sentence. Let us look at the adverb sometimes. It can go at the beginning of the sentence, as in, sometimes I walk to work. It can go after the subject, I sometimes walk to work. Or it can go at the end of the sentence, I walk to work sometimes. other adverbs can only go in the middle of a sentence. The adverb probably is an example. She will probably leave early. It is incorrect to say, probably she will leave early, or she will leave early probably. Other such adverbs are never, rarely, seldom, and always. These are called mid-sentence adverbs. They usually go between the subject and the main verb. Different types of adverbs have different sentence positions.
Adjectives describe nouns, while adverbs describe verbs, adjectives, and other adverbs. Take the sentence, "She is careful." The adjective careful is describing the noun she. But if you said, "She walks carefully," the adverb carefully is describing the verb walk.
Native speakers sometimes confuse adverbs and adjectives. The words hard and hardly are especially difficult. Hard is both an adjective and an adverb. You can say, "The bed was hard," using the adjective, which means it is very firm. You can also say, "I worked hard," using the adverb, which means with a lot of effort. Hardly is an adverb. A long time ago, it meant in a hard manner, but its meaning has changed. People used to say not hardly. Over time, the word not disappeared. Since the 1500s, hardly has meant almost not, or barely. For example, "I hardly had time to finish the project." This conflicting meaning of hard and hardly has become the basis for jokes.
Listen to cartoon character Homer Simpson playing with the confusion between hard and hardly. In the scene, Homer's co-workers are replaced with robots.
"So, you guys are my new co-workers. So, working hard or hardly working?" "I said, working hard or hardly working. Working hard or hardly working! Working hard or hardly working! It's a simple question!"
Homer is asking the robots if they are working hard, working with energy, or hardly working, only working a little. The robots, with their exact reasoning, do not understand the wordplay in the question.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Today on our national parks journey, we head to the far western part of Texas. The landscape here is severe. The Chisos Mountains rise from the desert. The Rio Grande River cuts deep into ancient limestone rock. Cactus plants flower under the intense sun. Welcome to Big Bend National Park. At first sight, Big Bend seems empty of life, but the park is home to many plants and animals. Over 450 kinds of birds can be found within the park, along with 75 mammal species and more than 50 kinds of reptiles. The park's diversity comes from its three different ecosystems. Within the park are mountain, desert, and river environments.
The Rio Grande sustains the park. The river starts high up in the Rocky Mountains. Melting mountain snow is its main source. It travels more than 3,000 kilometers on its way to the Gulf of Mexico. The river cuts through the dry Chihuahuan Desert. Big Bend National Park contains the northernmost part of this desert. It is the second largest desert in North America. Much of the desert is south of the border in Mexico. The Rio Grande serves as an international border between the United States and Mexico for about 1,600 kilometers. The park itself shares a border with Mexico for 189 kilometers. The Chihuahuan Desert is the largest ecosystem in the park. 80% of the park is desert. Animals like jackrabbits, roadrunner birds, and mule deer live in the Chihuahuan. Many cactus and yucca species thrive. These are succulent plants. Most succulents have thick, heavy leaves that store water. Cacti store water in their stems.
High up in the park's Chisos Mountains, you will find fir and pine trees, aspens, and maples. Temperatures here are much cooler than down on the desert floor. The entire Chisos Mountain range exists within Big Bend. It is the only mountain range in the United States that is fully within a national park. Its highest mountains, Emery Peak and Lost Mine Peak, each rise more than 2,000 meters above the hot desert floor. The woodland environment in the mountains is home to black bears, mountain lions, and gray foxes. It is also home to many kinds of birds. Visitors are drawn to the park because of its rare and unique bird species. One of these is the Colima warbler. These small gray, yellow, and red birds arrive at Big Bend in the springtime to mate and nest. Then they return south to Mexico. In the late summer, mountain sage flowers appear. Hummingbirds, blue-throated, ruby-throated, magnificent, and Lucifer seek out these flowers.
Along with its plant and animal life, the park is also rich in cultural history. Archaeological records of humans in the area go back about 10,000 years, beginning with the prehistoric Paleo-Indians. Later on, the Chisos Indians lived here, as did the Comanche and Jumano people and other native groups. Spanish explorers began to arrive in the area in the 1500s. They were searching for gold and fertile land. They described this land as despoblado, or uninhabited. Much of what is now Big Bend National Park was Mexican territory until 1848. Mexican settlers farmed and raised animals here. In the early 1900s, many Anglo-Americans began settling in the area.
Big Bend became a national park on June 12, 1944. It covers more than 320,000 hectares. President Franklin D. Roosevelt established the park just 1 week after D-Day. That is the day American and British troops invaded Normandy, France. As America's attention centered on World War II, Roosevelt established a new national park for future generations to enjoy. For several years before the park was created, hundreds of men worked to build roads and trails to prepare the area for visitors. They built the 11-kilometer road that leads to the Chisos Mountains Basin. A basin is a large area of the Earth's surface that is lower than the area surrounding it. Today, the basin is a popular place within the park. Visitors can stay in the Chisos Mountain Lodge there or at campgrounds. Many of the park's hiking trails begin near the basin. One of the most popular is the Lost Mine Trail. It starts near the Chisos Mountain Lodge. The trail goes up sharply through forests of pine, juniper, and oak trees. The 8-kilometer-long hike passes by lookout points for viewing Casa Grande Peak, one of Texas's major mountains. Hikers can also enjoy a view into the park's Juniper Canyon.
More than 300,000 people visit Big Bend each year. Most come between November and April, when the weather is cooler. A favorite way to explore the park is by boat on the Rio Grande. Many tour operators organize rafting trips. Rafting trips take you through many kilometers of beautiful deep canyons. They may last half a day or several days. On longer trips, travelers sleep next to the river in tents. Another way to enjoy the Rio Grande is in its many hot springs. These are places where hot water flows up from underground. The water temperature is over 40 degrees Celsius. The river's hot springs are said to have healing properties. They hold mineral salts from the earth. Big Bend National Park has offered beauty, excitement, and recreational challenge to visitors for more than 80 years. It is a true treasure of Texas and the larger United States. I'm Katie Weaver.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.